This lecture is about when sound occurs as a standing wave. When we graph a standing longitudinal wave, where the nodes and antinodes appear depends on which type of graph we're using. On a displacement graph, the nodes are where the compression and rarefaction occur. This is because those are the places on the standing wave where there's the least displacement. There's no displacement. The particles in those compressions and rarefactions of the standing wave do not move at all. So because those particles aren't moving, on a graph that measures the displacement of the particles on the y-axis, those particles that aren't displaced would be nodes. They just stay at zero throughout the whole time. And you can see that on that top graph, the displacement graph, the nodes line up with the particles that aren't moving in the animation, which is also where the compressions and rarefactions in the wave occur. On a graph of the pressure of the air, the antinodes are where the compression and rarefaction occur. So even though those particles aren't moving, that's where they feel the most or least air pressure from the other particles. When we're dealing with sound, it's more common to use a displacement versus distance graph than a pressure versus distance graph, so we'll use displacement distance graphs for the remainder of this video. You can see that in the standing waves here, the y-axis of the graph is graphing the displacement of the particles. When the particles move to the left, the displacement becomes negative, and when they move to the right, it becomes positive. And there are certain places where the particles are not being displaced at all. These are the nodes of the graph. So those red lines show you where the particles are not being displaced at all, and the midpoints of those lines are where they're displaced the most. When sound reflects off of a surface to create a standing wave, the particles next to the surface it's reflecting off of do not move in the standing wave. This means that the point at which sound reflects off a surface to create a standing wave will always be a node on a displacement distance graph. So you can see here that the particles on the right side of this animation are being pushed up against a wall that the air is reflecting off of and moving back to the left. So the particles at the very edge of that wall are being compressed and then pushing other particles back, but they themselves are not moving. So because they're not being displaced, they always make a node. So the point at which sound reflects and bounces back on itself will always be the node on a displacement distance graph of the longitudinal wave. So that bottom graph is what the displacement distance graph would look like for this specific standing wave. There's a very popular high school demo of standing waves and sound that involves a tube submerged in water and a tuning fork. We hold a tuning fork over the tube submerged in water and hit the fork so that it makes noise. As we raise the tube out of the water, we notice a pattern. So I'm going to imagine that we hit the tuning fork, hold it above the tube, and then observe a pattern in the sound as we lift the tube out of the water slowly. So just sit back and listen to what occurs when we hit the tuning fork and move the tube. This pattern exists because the sound is being reflected off the water, creating a standing wave in the tube. At the point of reflection, the standing wave is a node. As we raise the tube, the point on the wave that the opening is at changes from a node to an antinode and back. Because the frequency of the sound doesn't change, it's the same tuning fork, and because the velocity doesn't change, because it's the same material, air, the wavelength also doesn't change. So the standing wave isn't going to stretch out at all. So instead, as we raise the tube, we raise the opening from being at an antinode to a node to an antinode to a node. Once the sound leaves the opening, it's no longer in a standing wave. It's dissipated in all directions instead of moving up and down the tube. This means that the point on the standing wave that the tube is at determines the energy delivered to the air outside the tube. So let's observe that pattern again, this time where we can see the shape of the standing wave. I'm going to observe this pattern one more time. This time I'm going to pay attention to what the air particles inside the tube are doing, remembering that at an antinode, that's where their displacement is the greatest, and at a node, that's where they're not being displaced at all. They're not oscillating at all. So this is starting off at an antinode. So when there's an antinode, You can see that the air particles are oscillating into and out of the tube, so they must be delivering a lot of sound energy to the air outside of them, because sound energy is just the oscillation of air particles. So any air particles directly outside of that tube are getting hit by the air particles inside of the tube, and then that causes a wave to spread out in all directions. So at the antinode is where they're moving the most, so they're going to deliver the most sound energy to outside. I've now moved the tube up to where it's at the node in the air, and here you can see that those top air particles just aren't moving at all. And so because they're not moving, they're not going to oscillate any of the air outside of the tube. So there's no sound energy delivered to outside of the tube. Remember, that standing wave pattern isn't going to continue once the sound exits the tube. And so as a result, the only thing that determines the energy being delivered to the outside air is the energy of those particles on the top of the tube. And you can see that those particles are barely moving. And so they're not really going to deliver any sound energy to outside of the tube. We move it up to another antinode and we can very clearly hear the sound again, because again, this is where the most sound energy is being delivered to outside of the tube. And this is another node of the standing wave, so here there is no sound energy being delivered to outside. So that's why that sound pattern emerges as we raise the tube out of the water. Because we can physically hear where the antinodes occur, we can measure the exact distance between two antinodes. That distance is going to be equal to half the wavelength of the wave. Because the tuning fork usually has the frequency written on it, we can use the wavelength and frequency to find the velocity of the sound in the air. So if I listen for that antinode, and then listen for the next one, and measure the distance between those two antinodes, that length is going to be one half of the full wavelength. As an example problem, we can imagine that this tuning fork is 256 hertz, and we're holding it above this tube. As we raise the tube, the length between two consecutive points where the sound is loudest is 66 centimeters, and we want to know the frequency of the sound in the air. So the wavelength, 66 centimeters multiplied by 2 and then divided by 100 to convert to meters, is 1.32 meters. The frequency is 256 hertz. So the velocity of this sound must be 335 meters per second. So that's a very straightforward way of calculating the exact velocity of sound waves in air. Standing waves of sound in a tube behave similarly to transverse standing waves in a string or other material. For example, in most problems, if we have a tube with an open end, that open end is going to be an antinode. The reason why the open end of a tube is an antinode isn't because it physically has to be. We only want the open end to be an antinode if we want the maximum volume from the tube. We usually want the open end to be an antinode to get the most sound out of it. This isn't always the case, but in most problems that we do, we'll assume that the open end of a tube is an antinode, again, not because it physically has to be, but only because we're assuming that the tube has been designed to get the most sound out of that standing wave. Just like the fixed end of a rope, a closed end of a tube is a place where sound is reflected, and that's always going to be a node. That is a physical requirement. That's always going to have to be a node of a displacement graph of the sound standing wave. That's a place where the particles that the sound is moving through are not themselves oscillating. So we can get those same harmonics patterns that we got for the string using these shapes. This is what the first harmonic would look like in each shape. And these are the relationships between the wavelength, the length of the material that the wave is in. In the sound example, that material is a tube, and the frequency of the wave. Just like the string with one open end, if the tube has one open end, we skip straight from the first harmonic to the third harmonic. So these are the general patterns that emerge both for standing waves in strings and for standing waves of sound in tubes. So that's what you need to know about the properties of sound as a standing wave.